So yesterday we spoke about the complications of gallstones. Now, one of the most common complications that we would see in the acute care surgery unit here at Cholecystitis Hospital is, of course, acute cholecystitis. That is where the stone usually gets lodged, where the gallbladder goes over into the cystic duct. It is unlike biliary colic in that stone really stays there, and inflammation starts setting in. That stone is just stuck there. You start getting edema of the wall of the gallbladder itself, and with that engorgement, you get a little bit of venous congestion as well. You get infiltration of your immune cells, and you get patchy necrosis even as the blood struggles to flow properly through that area. So that's acute inflammation. About 50 to 75% of cases will actually have bacterial overgrowth, remember that. And then most of the time we'll see gram-negative bacilli, although we do see some streptococcus faecalis at times in certain circumstances. So that's the definition, really. It's just that gallstone getting stuck there. It's the most common cause of it, of course. We call it properly, and you must too, calculous cholecystitis, acute calculous cholecystitis, because of course you get the rare acalculus, and that's not what we're talking about. And so it's a gallstone cholecystitis, acute biliary cholecystitis, acute gallstone cholecystitis. Now, who are the people that you should look out for? So imagine you are confronted with this question in the exam. You might be given a clinical scenario, or you might just be asked to talk about acute cholecystitis, depending on what system your medical education is all about. So if you were just to talk freely about acute cholecystitis, first of all, what patients should you look out for? Well, there's definitely with us at least a preponderance to the female population. They usually in the middle ages, slightly younger, although we see all age ranges, I must say, of acute cholecystitis from early 20s right until our elderly population. So we really see it in a whole spectrum of ages. Some of the patients are slightly overweight. I'm not going to put this down as a disease of obesity, really. We see patients with absolutely normal weight and see patients with slight overweight. So it's not very clear why some people, when they develop gallstones and then cholecystitis. Remember, the vast majority of people with gallstones, as we discussed yesterday, they get an ultrasound and we pick up these gallstones, but those are totally asymptomatic. Or we pick up many asymptomatic gallstones these days for ultrasounds for other reasons. And so why some of them would go on to develop biliary colic and then acute cholecystitis, we don't know. So from biliary colic, obviously, you do get the cholecystitis. And the incidence is about, I would say, 2% more per year. So if you have a slightly younger patient with gallstones, the chances of getting acute cholecystitis are much higher because still probably a long time to live. In the elder population, you know, with that sort of incidence per year, perhaps not. So that's the patient population that we're really looking out for. So what do these patients present with? Well, they've got pain in their right upper quadrant, some in the epigastrium, some towards the back, some towards the shoulder. So just watch out. It's not always specific. And remember, the elderly, the diabetics, immunocompromised patients, they might not have a lot of symptoms at all. But let's stick to the normal. You're going to have a right upper quadrant pain, epigastric pain. And that pain persists for a couple of, not just a couple of hours like the biliary colic and then disappears. It really lasts for hours and then into days, even before they really come to us. So they've got this pain, they're nauseous with it or nauseated with that, and they feel like vomiting as well. So really feel ill. When you take their temperature, of course, their temperature is elevated. The majority of the time, they have a bit of a tachycardia. They're a bit dehydrated because they really don't feel like eating. And the first thing we would do for them is a symptomatic relief and putting up an intravenous line. You've got to check their electrolytes and then tailor your intravenous fluids, and you've got to let them take fluids orally, but an intravenous line and some analgesia. They really need some good proper analgesia. The blood test that we do, we would do a full blood count, and you are going to see a raised white cell count, and the majority of that's going to be neutrophils. And you might see a bit of raised urea on your urea and electrolytes as the patients are slightly dehydrated. And then on the liver function tests, you might see nothing. We see a lot of patients with normal liver functions, but some of them will have their cellular enzymes raised. Some of them will have their alkaline phosphatase raised. and the bilirubin must be normal. Once the bilirubin goes up, we're talking extrahepatic biliary obstruction. So that should really be normal. And we confirm the diagnosis, in our hands at least, just with an ultrasound. Now, when you examine these patients, you can elicit a Murphy sign. Remember, they'll be tender in their right upper quadrant. So you put your hand underneath the rib cage on the right-hand side and ask them to slowly breathe in. As you breathe in, your diaphragms move down, the liver moves down, pushes the gallbladder down, and it pushes that gallbladder, that tender gallbladder, into your hand, and that causes pain, and they stop. Now, on the ultrasound, you get an ultrasonic Murphy sign because the probe can see where the gallbladder is and press exactly on that. So that's a very good one. So on the ultrasound, we're going to see stones, the acoustic shadow of those stones. We're going to see thickening of the wall of the gallbladder. We might even see some pericholecystic fluid. So that's how we make our diagnosis. Now, in some areas, they also do a HIDA scan. That's from nuclear medicine. Remember that a normal cystic duct will then show if the cystic duct is not obstructed by the stone or cholecystitis, the whole gallbladder will fill up nicely on the HIDA scan. If not, then you know there's an obstruction and you can also diagnose acute cholecystitis. Remember, patients who haven't eaten for a while, we might get some false results, and the patients who haven't eaten in a while, so in the intensive care unit, that doesn't really work. So how do we treat these patients? Then, once confirmed, remember they've got the IV line, they've got the analgesia, we add antibiotics for them. Now, the mainstay of therapy is the surgery. They've got to go for a cholecystectomy, or the vast majority of them, if all else is fine, no recent heart attack or other anything else wrong. If at all possible, we do a cholecystectomy. And we try to do a cholecystectomy as soon as possible. Now, within about 3 days to a week, that's a very bad surgical period. Remember, the inflammation is at its worst and your complication rate is definitely going to be slightly higher, although there are people who are reporting that the incidence of complications are not higher. In our circumstances, these patients come in late and our theatres are overbooked, so it's very difficult to do a cholecystectomy, a laparoscopic cholecystectomy in the acute stage. So we usually treat them with antibiotics, and until they get better, send them home and bring them back for an elective procedure 6 weeks later. But the ideal would be patient comes in early and they have their cholecystectomy immediately. Now, for those patients who are too late, we treat them with antibiotics and they don't get better. For them, we put in a percutaneous cholecystostomy tube. It's sort of a new thing. We don't exactly know what the place of it is, how long to keep it in, what to do with it afterwards. And so we are busy with a research project in my research unit, just looking at what happens to these patients with the percutaneous drains. We also put the percutaneous drains in the gallbladder, of course, for the patients who are so ill and they have other comorbidities and they cannot go to theater. So in a nutshell, that is acute calculous cholecystitis.